appreciative of this man of God. We thank him for being here in his busy work schedule. But we know God will always make a way for him to bring the word to the body of Christ. So without any further ado, please receive him, if you don't mind standing on your feet, for our very own Pastor Michael Guinn.
Let the church say thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Let the church say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Let the church say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Let the church say hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen. We thank God for his movement of his spirit. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I want to be a follower of Christ. I want to be one of his disciples.
That's a whole song. Come on now.
I want to walk in the newness of life. So let me be a follower of Christ. I want to be a follower of Christ. I want to be one of his disciples.
Come on now.
Such a special day today. Thank God for all the birthdays. Amen. Thank God for the apostle Renee as well as for Ernest. I heard the announcement of the program on the radio where he was ministering at. Yeah? Yeah? Praise God. God is moving. Amen. Everybody say God is moving.
God is moving.
Right then. Y'all know what I'm going to do. Repeat after me.
All right.
Running with the running man.
Running with the running man.
All the way to his glory.
All the way to his glory.
Look to somebody else and say, I am running with the running man.
I am running with the running man.
All the way to his glory.
All the way to his glory.
Okay, that's enough to start preaching right now. Amen. Praise God. Let us pray. Father, we thank you right now in the name of Jesus. We thank you for everything that you have done and how you have moved on your spirit through this wonderful day. For truly, God, you are so worthy of our praise and our honor. I honor you, God. I bow before your presence, God. Oh, in my spirit, God, I yield my members up to you. God, we thank you right now for your wonderful people that have come to hear your word. God, you send your word, Lord. Teach us on today. Share today, God. Open our hearts, our mind, our understanding, that we will receive what thus says the Lord in his last and evil days. The race is not given to the swift, nor to the strong, but to him that endured.
The Bible tells us in Psalm 147:15.
He sendeth forth his commandment upon the earth. His word runneth very swiftly. Psalms 119:32. I will run the way of thy commandment when thou shalt enlarge my heart. Amos 8:11-12 says, behold, the days cometh, saith the Lord, that I will send a famine in the land, not a famine of bread, nor a thirst for water, but the hearing of the words of the Lord.
Yes.
And they shall wander from sea to sea, from north even to the east. They shall run and go to see the word of the Lord and shall not find it. Habakkuk 2:1-5. I will stand upon my watch.
Yes.
Set me upon the tower. I will watch to see what he will say unto me.
Yes.
And what I shall answer when I am reproved. And the Lord answered me and said, write the vision and make it plain upon the tablets, that he may run that readeth it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time.
Come on.
But at the end it shall speak, yes, and not lie.
Not lie.
Though it tarry, wait for it. But it will surely come. It will not tarry.
Yes.
Behold, his soul, which is lifted up, is not upright in him. But the just shall live by faith.
All to Jesus I will bring. I surrender everything. Not my will, but Christ in me. I'm yours. Undeserving I receive everlasting love for me. All I ever want to be is yours. And oh, it's amazing how you love me. My life
is not my
life is not my own. You and you alone.
I remember when I was in the military testimony. I was in one of the NCO academies. I was learning leadership traits. And the learning leadership traits, they brought in, each group come in, and out of the group class I was in, it was not that big of a class. I think we might have had 10 people in my group. But it was a class that came after us, and the way they do it, you're in there for 2 months. So the first month you get there, you know you're brand new. Y'all know how when you're brand new, people take advantage of you, right? Huh? The veterans want to show the newbies or the rookies how it's done. So we had this thing that we did on PT. You know what PT is? Physical training, excuse me. And some of you that was in the Army, I don't know about the Navy or the Air Force. Marines, I tip my hat to you. But one thing I say about the Army, we would run Monday, Wednesday, and Friday.
Uh-huh.
But when I was in the leadership training course, we ran every day. Now, something unique about this run, those that had been there a month before ahead of us, they were strong. They had learned the mystery how to run this race.
Right.
The race that we would do, we would have a lead person that was always on the right side. And this person, just like in any race, they set the pace.
Yeah.
Now this person that set the pace in my group was a woman.
Yeah.
Now the first time when we first ran, we ran with this other class, and we had just got there, and we struggled. And then we came to the conclusion when we got to the advanced stages and was about to graduate, now we had endured the training. We was prepared for the race.
Yeah.
So what we did, we took the woman and put her on the end. It looked like she was the slowest, but she was the one that set the pace. And as we started to run that race, we ran as a team running. And the people behind us was running. They said, oh yeah, this ain't gonna be nothing. Oh, this ain't gonna be nothing. We got this. Then we kept on running. As we noticed each mile that we went, we increased the pace. So the pace got a little bit faster. Then we start hearing some noise behind us and some, man, I need to slow down. I need to slow down. And then when we got closer to the end, we kicked it into high gear. When we kicked it into high gear, you heard people behind us coughing, gasping. Oh, please slow down. Stop. Whoa, stop. What y'all doing? When we finished, we turned and said to them, your day is coming. See, what we do a lot of time in our lives, when we run this race called Jesus Christ, God has set up a marathon race that is not like a natural race, because the beautiful thing about a marathon race is it's not whoever get across there first. It's the truth of the matter is that everyone make it. Do you know in a marathon, you know who they really rejoice the most? It's not the first person.
Right.
It's not the second person. It's not the third person. It's not the person with all that ability and strength and training that knows how to run. It is that last person that's struggling. That sometimes during the course they was running, they fell to their knees. That one that did not have the strength in their members to get up, but for somehow, some way, they were able to stand to their feet. Though their legs was wobbling, they stood to their feet and they got up again. Much slower than everybody else. Everyone else is running past him. I remember one marathon they had a man that was 80 years old.
Yeah.
This man could barely move, but he was in the race.
Right.
And they tell us that when this man came, it was near the end of the day. The sun was coming down. And all of a sudden it was coming to night, but this 80-year-old man was still running. He had people that was behind him cheering him on. He had people in the side of him cheering him on. He had people in the front, and this is the beautiful body, or even those that run the race stayed there and waited on that man.
Wow.
When that man got there, the one that was in first place began to yell. When that man got there, the one that was in second place began to yell. When that man got there, the one that was in third, fourth, fifth, seventh, eighth, tenth place, they all began to yell. Why? Because they saw a man that was struggling, that did not have the ability that they had. But as the Bible says, the grace is not given to the swift, nor to the strong, but to those that endure to the end. See, it's something about God that God really is trying to do for us today, saints. Do you know that God is looking for us to go to the inner closet, to the secret place?
Uh-huh.
Yes. Now, this inner closet is not the way we think all the time. We think because you go home the way the scripture says, literally, yeah, you can't do this. You run into a closet, you close the door, all of a sudden you get down on your knees and you begin to pray. God is looking for a love relationship. God is looking for someone that will forsake mother, brother, husband, wife, children, job, and anything else that may hinder them from coming to the presence of God. God is looking for a love relationship. A man ought to love Jesus Christ just like he loved his wife. A wife ought to love Jesus Christ just like she loved her husband. Matter of fact, in even a greater measure.
Yes, yes.
See, my wife is my best friend.
Amen.
Man, hear me now. I hang around some time with God.
Wow.
Well, my dad told me many years ago.
Right.
All
right.
He said, them same guys that you're hanging around with, though they are your friends today, by the time you get to an adulthood, them same guys, you will not see them no more.
All right.
All right.
That was true spoken in the sun. And then all of a sudden, I began to think on that thing. I said, wow, that is something. And then God began to say, I said, God said, I'm going to show you something here. If you seek me in my presence, I will begin to reveal to you things that are hidden from most people.
Wow.
The reason why people don't get the revelation from God's word like they ought to is because we're not spending enough time in the inner closet. Wow. Now I'm here to tell you right now, as close as Elder Quinn is to me, she don't know when I go in.
All right.
Huh? Matter of fact, she is so confused because she don't even know when my secret time is.
Yeah.
But I'm here to tell you right now, when you have a personal relationship with Jesus, yeah, and Jesus comes first in your life, your secret place cannot and will not be known by any man.
Yeah.
The Bible tells us that when Jesus himself, God wrapped in flesh, times that he left the disciples, he went away unknowing to them where he went.
Right.
So you got to get to that secret place in God. I've come to the realization that my secret place is God. It's not based on the foundation of traditional prayer. But every time you open your mouth, every time you in your car, every time you in the house and nobody else is there, every time you go into the bathroom, the second office, and close the door, and begin to seek God, God will bring on you and rain on you his word like never before. Calling to all of us all the time.
Amen.
It took me years and I'm still learning. But what I'm finding out, the more time I separate from humans and I spend more time with God, and that means you got to come back to people. Why? Because that's where our work is at.
Right.
Remember, God, we're running with the running man. The running man is the Holy Spirit of God.
Right.
The Holy Spirit of God is the one that's guiding and leading us.
Yes.
But the beautiful thing about the running man is teaching us how to run.
Yes.
And if we're not spending time with the running man, how are you going to run this race?
That's so good.
We need the kingdom. Because we are running with the running man all the way to glory. Anybody running? Anybody running? You doing it? Anybody running? My God. Yeah. I'm running all the way.
Yeah.
I don't know about you, but I am running for my life. And if anybody asks you, what's the matter with me? Just tell them I'm saved. Saved of God. Holy Ghost filled. Fire baptized. I got Jesus. Oh my God. And I'm running. I don't know about y'all, but I'm running. And I'm not ashamed. Oh, I wish I had about five people that weren't ashamed. But hey, I'm running.
Resist the devil, and he will what?
Flee
from you. But do you know there's sometimes you need to run yourself? You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Look at Joseph. Come on now, get deep with me.
Come on.
Joseph was a man after God's own heart.
Yes.
Everything he did, it turned to gold. Every time somebody tried to tear him to pieces, God always always came in the midst. Why? Because his heart was right with God, and he had a relationship with God, and he also listened to the running man.
Yes.
Joseph was part of his wife. She desired him so bad.
Come on.
Not only was a man young, but he was intelligent as well. And because her husband, as I'm going into the history, her husband was much older than she was. See?
That's what it was.
So she saw that young man that was placed in a position of authority. I'm here to tell you, when God puts you in a position of authority, remember this, the devil is always leaping to take you out of that position. See, God, the devil don't want you to be in a position of authority. Why? Because you can't influence people into the things pertaining to God. So what the devil tries to do when you get elevated, the devil always tries to do to tear you down. People will start making junk and the stuff that's not true about you. And
just the same people do some worse things than you ever did, and they just look the other way.
Yeah, sure, he did take a whole bunch of money, but he's all right.
Why do you think they're doing that?
Because that same person that's all right, it's the same one got some dirt on the one that's in charge and says it's all right. In other words, if he fire that person, he's going to fire himself. Because you know how people are. When they get in trouble, they're going to tell everything that they know. That's right. They'll start saying it.
Everybody
going. Y'all heard no saying. Oh, you're going to drop a dime on me. I'm going to drop a 50 cent on you. Oh, you ain't going to get me. You just got 10 cents. I got 50.
By the time they feel a telling that with your stuff on you, everybody will be there with their mouth open wide, including you.
Amen. Jesus is pulling us. He's drawing us. He wants us. He loves us. He needs us. He wants to use us.
But we can deliver the word of God. And ain't nobody gonna hit you in the mouth.
Wow.
Ain't nobody gonna push you down those steps.
Wow.
Unless you talk to the wrong person.
Nobody's gonna shoot you.
Wow.
We got to learn to see it the way God. Once we open our mouth and begin to say anything, the Bible says the Spirit of God kicks in. Many of you in this room know exactly what I'm talking about. Some of you have not studied a particular topic, and you ran into somebody, and all of a sudden, you don't know where that knowledge came from.
Right.
But when you open your mouth, you start saying stuff that you didn't have a clue, but you know it came from the Spirit of God.
Right.
See, the thing about the Spirit of God, the Spirit of God knows everything.
Yes.
You may not know it, but the Spirit of God does. So when we are obedient to the Spirit of God and we open our mouth and God begins to use this vessel, it is God that is speaking out of us. It is not you.
Yes,
sir. So we got to get to the mindset that is not based on what I know, but it's based on the power of the Holy Ghost down in the inside. For what I lack in any kind of limitation by the Holy Spirit and His power, God will allow me to do the one that talks all the time. It's the one that what? Listens. And people are sitting there and say, oh my God, he can talk so good. And you didn't say a word. And I say to you today, these are folks that don't know how to talk along too. Uh-huh. I'm going to stop messing with those people that's quiet. Y'all know how we get. Oh dear, I'm not going to talk. We not the Lord. But there's some people that are so quiet, you don't know, well, sure they don't know about you anything, do you? You push the wrong button.
Come on down.
Not only will they tell you about yourself, they'll go back in the past and bring you some stuff you did. They'll look at your present and tell you some things you did in the present. And if God is moving, they'll tell you some things that you ain't made up to if you don't get it right. Which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God.
Yes.
John 14, 26 and 7. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Spirit, which the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance. Whatsoever I said unto you, peace I give unto you, my peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth, give it I unto you, lest not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. We are called as ambassadors. Y'all know what it is. Any foreign country that has you an ambassador to, you're in the United States, you go to Spain, wherever that building sits, it's the United States property. Wherever you are sitting, you are the property of Jesus Christ. See, we are in a land that may not accept you. But because we are in this world, not of this world, but we're in this world for the purpose of God. Why? Because we are part of the body of Christ. The Bible teaches in the book of Romans that sweet and blessed and beautiful are the feet of them that carry the gospel of Jesus Christ. Every place you step, God is stepping. Every time you open your mouth and deliver God's word, God is moving on the heart of that man or that woman. For he says the word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword, cutting between the bone and the marrow and dividing the soul and the spirit to bring them unto salvation. See, many of us think in our mind and we say that if I was there during that time and I saw Jesus, that I would have just followed him wholeheartedly. But I'm here to tell you today that it wasn't for the power of God. If it weren't for God being with you, and amen, if you had not been changed in your mind, that we might have been the one that was in the crowd that cried out to crucify him and give me Barabbas. You might have been the one that was there on the cross and nailed him in his hand. Or you might have been the one, the soldiers, that took his robe and when they laid it down, they gambled on the possession. You might have been the one that whipped him. You might have been the one that sold him for 30 pieces of silver. We might have, but I tell you today, the Bible tells us in Matthew that he went through 14 generations. From the part of Abraham, even unto David, was 14 generations. And even from the time of unto David to the captivity of Babylon was 14 generations. And even from the time of Babylon to Christ was 14 generations. I'm here to tell you today that it was 42 generations that Jesus Christ came on the scene over 3,000 years ago. He looked and he saw that this man that would come out of the womb of a woman that the name was Dorothea.
getting to close. And a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense, even to them which stumble at the word, being disobedient, whereunto also they were appointed. But ye are chosen generation,
yes,
a royal priesthood,
yes,
a holy nation,
yes,
a peculiar people,
yes,
that you should show forth the praises of him who have called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, unto his glory.
Yes.
We walk a newness today in his glory. God is working with us in his glory. We are made stronger than anything else that the world may throw upon us in his glory. Now, once the Holy Ghost has prepared us, you. We are the running man. We are the running man. We are the hands and the feet of God. We are the one now that will go places that God said. He says, greater works shall you do.
Uh-huh.
He's saying that because we are the ones that will deliver his word. We are the ones that will lay hands upon the sick,
yeah,
and they will recover. We are the ones that will bring glad tidings to the world that are in chaos and in sin. We are the ones. You are the running man. You are the one that God has saw long before you ever came up. God saw you and prepared the way.
Yes.
Makes no difference what you're going through. You are the running man. God has built you up because you obey the Spirit of God. And I'm here to tell you, once you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior and has been filled with the infilling of the Holy Ghost, with evidence of speaking in tongues as God gives the utterance, amen, you are now the running man, and it's time to run this course. Not only are you running for yourself, but you're running for those that God sent you to. You're running to them that are around you. You're running to them that see you. For the Bible says that we are epistle read by all men. There's no secret in God when he reveals you. The way God wants you to hear, will it be one today that will be honest enough and come forth and say, yes, God, I need to run this race?
Yes.
Will it be one today that will not be decided by the people that are sitting beside you? You'll get to the point that you're not even worried about him. You'll say, God, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of your prayer.
Yes.
Or will it be one today that not will look upon themselves and think that they're not worthy, will look upon the things they did in the past and look upon the things that they may have done this week, look upon the things that they have done today and say, I'm just not worthy? I'm here to tell you today that that spirit is alive from the pits of hell. You are worthy today. You are called by the power of God, and you are somebody in Jesus Christ. Oh, you so special. That God took himself and he hung himself on the cross. How far is the east from the west? As far as he stretched his hands out wide.
Yes,
how